Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In my choice to develop my loving self presentation, Jesus teaches that development of our loving self is a will-based choice, outlines the qualities needed for development, what is involved in loving self-expression, and how desire for God's love and truth is essential to receiving an education in love. Recorded on the 28th of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Karen, here are you. Muzzle, if you're going to ask something, muzzle. Use the mic so everyone can hear. Thanks.
I know you've got a long list of priorities, but I would really love it if one day you were able to write a story of your life after returning.
After returning?
Yeah.
All right.
Just, you know, like when
it's pretty boring life, but anyway.
No, like when you give us some of the details of what you do, it's like so helpful.
Right.
And one question I had that I thought of after you told us about your going through your terror.
Yeah.
You were saying that at the time you'd kind of thought God had given up on you. And when did God introduce herself back to you? Was that during or after or nothing to do with
it? I wouldn't say God introduced herself back to me. It's like God's always been there. It's just me feeling that I was rejected, you know. Because I was rejected. Because I walked out on my religious faith, there was the projection at me that I was written off by God by that faith. So basically the Jehovah's Witnesses believe that if you walk out on the faith, so I disassociated myself from that faith. And what they believe that when you do that, basically you're consigning yourself to when you die, you just will be dead forever. And in fact, there is a general feeling for many of them that they should treat you as if you're dead from that point onwards. Mm. So that's what they did. They treated me as if I was dead, and they encouraged my sons to treat me as if I was dead as well, and so forth. So that was quite hard on them too. But as a result of that, I just sort of felt like, well, you know, I still hadn't given a lot of consideration about how God felt about me doing it. I just felt that it was a necessary thing to do. It was basically a process where I felt really that, you know, I felt bad because of the projections coming from that religion to myself, and by my family were all of the same faith, so they basically treated me that way as well. So that was the main reason why I felt that way. Once I worked through that emotionally, then I felt that God was different to that. So it took me probably, I don't know, 12 months to 18 months to work through that emotionally. And then after that, I started feeling like, well, no, God doesn't write people off like that, you know.
Mm. So it wasn't an association with your experience of terror. It was part of a longer thing.
Yeah, it's part of a longer belief systems, deconstructing some of these false beliefs, you know.
Yep.
Mm. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I suppose one day all the 14 will get around to writing their memoirs, if you want to call them that, but I don't think for all of us it's a very high priority, to be honest. It's really interesting as you progress, because once you've let go of certain emotional issues with inside of yourself, it's like you sort of don't even really remember them anymore. And a person has to sort of remind you of, you know, what happened back then before you sort of remember them. And because of that, it's like, yeah, it is difficult to recall some of the things in the proper sequence and order and everything, you know, because the emotional signature of it all has gone. So one of the reasons why we're teaching what we're teaching you now is because I'm sort of now feeling like I don't really want to teach this material anymore. And as I progress, that will be more and more the case, because there's new things I'd like to teach. And Mary's going through the material now, so it's really helpful when we work. Like, this program has been developed with Mary and myself together, and that's really helpful because Mary's going through it, so she can, you know, she can remind me of what I've, you know, so talk about what she's going through, and reminds me of what I've been through, and so forth. And so that helps us a lot when we're putting together this kind of material. But honestly, it's not something that we intend to continue teaching. It's not like we'll develop these courses and then we'll do them again at some point in the future. It's not going to be like that.
Yeah.
And that's one reason why we want to put them on video, obviously, because we don't really have an intention of doing them again once they're done. Yeah. All right. How this morning? Everyone's good this morning? A little nippy this morning it was. If you got up early, it was a little cool. Yep. Have my traditional bounce and a little swim. Bit cool when you got out of the water. So this is where our subject is this morning, my choice to develop my loving self. And that's what we're going to focus our attention on in the next hour or so. Everyone's ready for it? Okay. Okay, so now we're getting down to the theme that we've had for the entire week, really, which is to develop my loving self. And now what we're looking at yesterday, what we saw was that we had that God's created our real self and all of these different things that God gave us at the time of creation allows us to develop ourselves, and we have the choice of developing ourselves in an unloving way as well as a loving way. And that's the beautiful thing about the gift of free will. God allows us to develop in any way that we wish. And assuming that you would like to develop in a loving way, we also saw that in the afternoon yesterday, that God has a whole heap of gifts that God's already given us. Right at the time of our creation, God gave us gifts. Then at the time of, I suppose you could say, at the time that we became aware, God's given us a lot of gifts. And there's also a lot of gifts of potential that God's given us as well to allow us to develop in any way that we see fit. So now you can see from all of that that it really gets down to what I'm going to do with that. What I'm going to do with these gifts and this potential that God's given me. And this is where I feel we need to understand most fully the aspect of my choice. It's a will-based decision. It's a decision based on your soul's feelings and emotions, but that can be developed. You can develop an aspiration to make a choice in a loving direction. So development of my loving self really is the critical factor, is what I choose to do. All of the environment from God's perspective and all of God's laws and everything that God has given us has all primed us to do it, but it just gets down to whether I am going to do it, doesn't it? What choice I am going to make. And this is why in the Paget messages, when we talked to Paget, we were frequently referring to the fact that it's only humankind that can stop the process using their will. And for the majority of us, we have not necessarily been conscious of the fact that we've been stopping the process of our own education in love and stopping the process of our own development in love. But now that we are aware, we can change that particular intention and develop a different intention, a different aspiration from our soul. And this gets down to the choices that we're now going to need to make in order to develop our loving self. So the number one thing we need to remind ourselves is, I have some decisions to make. I have some choices to make. I am the person who has the power, because God gave me this power and ability, I have the power to reject an education in love. I have the power to reject God. So God's got everything ready, but I've got the power to reject it or accept it. And so it's going to get down to, the critical thing is going to get down to, what are my decisions? What am I going to choose to do with regard to my development? Everyone can see that? That it's the personal choice. And I can't emphasize that enough. So every time you're stagnant, we must always realize that it is our personal choice to be. And usually those choices, given the fact that there's a lot of beautiful things ahead of us if we follow God's way, the choices to remain stagnant must be driven by fear, because there's not many other motivations, really, is there, to do it other than fear being the primary, if you like, the primary dictating factor. So you can see the problem is the facade and the pain, and particularly the fear of the pain, prevents me from making what would be in the end wise choices for me to develop my loving self. You are going to actually experience the most extreme happiness if you develop your loving self, and if you refuse to develop your loving self, or you decide to develop yourself in an evil manner, towards degradation, then you're going to experience some extreme pain or unhappiness as a result of that choice. And we need to see that as our personal choice. We need to see it as a decision, a soul-based decision, not a willpower decision, but a soul-based decision that we need to at some stage make in our lives. Makes sense, doesn't it? So what are the decisions we need to do? Now, if you've got the outline from today, you can see that there's some personal qualities that I'm going to need to help me make this wise decision or wise choice. Now, these personal qualities, you've seen them all before, because they are the tools that we introduced, the majority of them are the tools we introduced in our first group. So the first tool that's going to help me make wise choice is faith, isn't it? Now, what kind of faith are we talking about? Well, we're talking about the kind of faith where we have faith in God's goodness, faith in God's laws, faith in God's love, faith in love itself, that love itself is going to be the thing that causes us to become happy. We need to have faith in these things. The world does not have a lot of faith in those things. In fact, the world has far more faith in fear and evil than it has in anything that's good and loving, right? And you can see this playing out in the world frequently, right? So we're going to need to develop this quality of faith and have the aspiration to develop it. It's a quality we're going to need. And you see that faith has been popping up all the way through this presentation, hasn't it? In terms of a necessary quality. In fact, it's highly unlikely you'll choose to deal with your facade unless you have faith. It's highly unlikely you'll choose to feel your global terror unless you have some faith. And it's highly unlikely that you'll feel your pain unless you have faith. So faith is an essential quality that is a personal quality that's inside of oneself that needs to be developed. Now, we all have begun with having no faith or very little faith, and also generally a resistance to faith, because we like to stay in a state of doubt. And the main reason why we like to do that is that it stops us from having to take action. It stops us from having to be in disagreement with the world. It stops us from getting attacked by the world. And there's a lot of other motivations, most of them fear-based motivations, that cause us to desire to not have faith, to remain cynical and to remain doubtful. But we can change that. And it's a decision inside of ourselves that we need to make to change that. Okay, so another one obviously is truth, isn't it? And here we're talking about having a beautiful heartfelt seeking desire for truth. You know, most of us have a deep resistance to truth. Again, the resistance driven by, you know, the fear that we have within us and the fear of our pain, and we're trying to hold on to false beliefs and false definitions of love because of the way the world sees everything. It's different to how we will see things, and we know it's going to be different, and we know it's probably going to confront the world in some way around us. And by the world, for most of us, that's generally just people around us, friends, family, and so forth. People will be confronted, and we don't want that to occur. And so we shut down this natural desire that we have to actually seek the truth. And seeking the truth and finding it are some of the most exquisite joys that you'll ever have. And yet we shut it all down and decide not to seek and find and come to a conclusion. We're afraid of coming to conclusions. Of, is this true, yes or no? And the world is addicted to grey areas. Have you noticed that? Right? It's addicted to being able to say, maybe it's right, but maybe it's wrong. Or maybe there's just shades of grey in between. Maybe there's just like, you know, some situations are not cut and dried. You know, they're not definite. They, you know, that you can a little leeway here and a little leeway there, and before we know it, that's what we're doing with our life. We're actually turning our life into that, where we ourselves live in shades of grey. Right? And that's not the way that God intended. And it's certainly not the way that you're ever going to be happy, because there's so much that you don't know in that state, and there's so much that's happening to you that you can't understand, and there's so much that happens to you in that state that causes further pain, and then we start blaming other things for this pain rather than what the real cause is. And the fact is that we're ignoring truth. So this desire for truth, very important for us, isn't it? All right, now we've also talked about taking action. Now here we're referring to the choice to take loving action. You know, you can always act, but up here you're acting all the time, right, in this facade. The stuff that's going on in this facade here, you're acting all the time. But that's not the kind of action that we want to engage. We want to engage loving action, and we want to know what the definition of loving action actually is. Don't we? We need to see what loving action actually is. So we're talking here about taking some loving action with ourselves and our life and the choices we make, the decisions we follow through on. And so instead of just coming up with ideas and plans, which we never carry out, right? So, you know, there's plenty of people in the world with lots of really good ideas. But most sit down in front of the telly, in the Western world at least, or in front of a Game Boy or whatever else it is that we have to distract us, and never actually engage the plans. Or we get so hung up in providing for ourselves physically that we don't engage the other bigger plans that we have for our life. And so we look back, sometimes you can look back 20 years and you start asking yourself, well, how different is my life now than it was 20 years ago? Not much different really. And you don't want that to continue to be the case. Taking loving action will reverse that, will change that. Then we also talked about the emotions. So let's use the term, what it really is, humility. This is another, so these are personal qualities, right? These are things that you need to develop the aspiration to do within yourself if you really want to progress. So these are personal things to be done, personal requirements, if you like. The personal requirement of humility is allowing yourself to feel and experience all of your emotions, positive or negative, doesn't matter. You're not selecting them anymore. You're just living them. You're being them, rather than selecting them anymore. Now, these tools are essential tools. But let's add to it one more. The desire to experiment and, you could add to that, make mistakes. Now, a humble person would do that probably naturally, wouldn't they? They would just engage life, experiment, test out this, test out that. A person who's seeking truth would love to do experiments, would they not? A person who takes action, if they don't know what action to take, they'd do some experiments to work out what action to take, would they not? A person who has faith would also have an idea, well, oh, I want to do experiments that are around love, not around the opposite of love. So rather than experimenting with your addictions further, you'd be better off experimenting with denying some addictions and seeing what happens, do you see? Acting in harmony with love when you experiment. So the key is to experiment, acting in harmony with love during these experiments, and allow yourself to make some mistakes. Now, from God's perspective, we've talked about mistakes, haven't we? And I keep reminding you that mistakes are not mistakes of knowledge is not the problem from God's perspective, because God designed us to have no knowledge at the beginning and to process and finish up learning knowledge through our own desire and through our own expression of our own will. So God actually designed us to know nothing at the beginning, and God loves a little baby who's just born who knows nothing as much as God loves a person who's an adult who knows as like, even if they knew as much as God knew, which is actually impossible, but even if we did, God would still love us the same no matter what we knew. So making mistakes is not the problem when it comes to making mistakes in knowledge. So you're going to make mistakes. You're going to say some things today or tomorrow, and then a few months' time or a year's time, you're going to work out, no, that wasn't right. I've worked it out now. It's not that at all. You'll make some mistakes about your own assessment of yourself. You will. You'll go, oh, I think I'm here. And then a few months later, oh, I wasn't there. I'm maybe there now, you know. And then a few months later, you go, oh, I wasn't there. and you'll make these mistakes in your assessments even of things. That's normal. The key is to not make mistakes when it comes to being loving. Because if you're loving, then you know that pain will not result from the action of being loving. Pain only results from the action of being unloving, right? From sinning. So we need to make mistakes, but we need to allow ourselves to make sure that the mistake isn't to sin all the time. Because it's the sinning all the time, whether we're conscious of our sin or not, it's the sinning all the time that creates more pain. So it doesn't make much sense to do that. So we need to allow ourselves to experiment and make mistakes, but avoid sin. Now, you're not even going to always avoid sin, are you? Because you, while you've got pain in you, while you've got terror in you, the motivation to sin from within out of oneself is quite strong. So you're not always going to be able to avoid sin, but the key is to pick yourself up from it and to look at it and go, okay, this is driven by an emotion or a belief system that I need to release, and I need to get down into that emotionally and work my way through that if I want to not do that not commit that sin anymore. And so that's what we would do as well. We'll make a choice to do that. So it really gets down to these choices we make every day, the choices and decisions we make. Very important choices and decisions we need to learn to make. Is there any questions about that before I move on? It's all stuff that we've talked about to a degree. But we need to see all of these things as our choice. Yvonne, thanks.
It's just a comment. You've added will to the list in the overview as well.
Well, yes, the reason why I've added will to this is that all of those things, the development of every single one of those things, requires our will. Mm-hmm. And that's why in the beginning, in the first presentation we did with you, the first week, we focused your attention on developing your will first, because without your will, nothing else will be achieved. You won't develop faith, you won't long for truth, you won't take action, you won't feel your emotion, you won't experiment, you won't try to make mistakes and learn from them. You just won't do any of those things, right? You'll be closed down from achieving those particular things. So the will is an essential part of this process, and you must always remember that. Always go back to your first lesson, because that is where you can change. That's the thing that needs to be developed, the will. All right, so what's next? What's next with regard to these things? Well, now what we need to do to develop our loving self is we need to focus our attention on our expression. How we express ourselves, how we live our lives, if you could say. And in the notes, you'll notice I've called it how personal expression is needed for development. See, loving yourself and being loving to others requires you to be yourself. So let's define what being myself is. Well, being myself is firstly feeling all my emotions. It doesn't matter what they are, and they could, some, as we can see here, some of them might be unloving, but we still need to feel them. That's a part of being myself, learning to be myself. So whenever you deny you have an emotion inside of you of a kind that's actually there, then you're not being yourself, right? And to be, you need to learn to be yourself before you can even identify what's wrong with yourself. Can you see that? And what could be changed in yourself. So this requires feeling all of my emotion under all circumstances. Now we'll talk a bit more about that when we're going to have a whole talk this afternoon on being ourselves, right? My choice to be myself. And so we're focusing our attention on this talk about developing myself and what I'm going to need. And later we'll be looking at what we're going to need to be ourselves, just to be who we are. And we'll spend a lot more time looking at that later. But you can see feeling all of your emotions is a very key part of being you. Right? So every time you suppress your emotion, you're not being you. Every time you lie about your emotion, you present the facade to the world, you're not being you. Right? Every time you live in your addictions, you're not being you. You're not being honest about the fact that there's a great big vortex is driving these addictions. And to be you, you have to feel the vortex. You have to feel the neediness, feel what you think you need and work your way through that. That would be more like being you. Right? And we need to learn, as we learnt right back in the accepting our facade area, that we've got to stop judging who we are. Right? We're a bit of a mixture of things at the moment, aren't we? We've got some real self in there that we haven't developed very much, that we don't really know much about. It's very hard for us to sort of touch it or feel it at this stage because we don't really know much about it. But then there's also this pain that was created by our own sin and our parents' sin and society's sin, and that's there as well inside of us, all percolating around, and some of it's being suppressed and some of it's being expressed, frequently being expressed. And we've got to learn to accept that place, accept that's what we are. And we've also got to get to the stage where we realise, oh boy, a lot of my life and a lot of what I think I really like doing are just really just my addictions. They're just things I do because they give me what the needy holes in me demand. All right, so these are all things that we need to allow ourselves to be. That doesn't mean that we have to dump all that on others, does it? We just need to allow ourselves to be it. So you can do that quite easily by just allowing yourself to feel like, wow, that particular person, I just keep wanting to gravitate to that person. What's going on there? There's a compulsion driving me to do this. So what's this compulsion driving me? Is it actually based on love, or is it really just based on the fact that there's something in them that I feel is going to feed something in me, and if I do something for them, they'll do something for me, and I've got my codependent barter or addiction going on? Is that what's driving me? These are what I need to do. But I need to still feel my emotion. It's no good just suppressing it, because as soon as you suppress it, you're not being you anymore. You need to allow yourself to feel your emotion. Okay. What else? You've got the notes. Most of you would have read some this morning. What else do we need to do to express ourselves? Share myself. Okay. So I need to share myself. Now, Of course, we'll talk later about what it means to share myself as a different idea or concept to being myself, right? And we'll discuss that in a lot more detail in our next presentation. But sharing yourself means that, you know, you've got to stop hiding yourself. You know, most of you are just letting the real self, like I said yesterday, just peek out behind the curtain occasionally and looks at the world, says it's all too scary out there, closes it all back up again. Isn't that what it's like a lot of the times? And then we go to a person who we're, you know, attracted to spending some time with, either from an emotional perspective or a sexual one or whatever, we peek out a bit there, just test the waters. We're sort of like a person, aren't we, a lot of the times, going to the pool and sort of going, dip my toe in, is it going to be cold or not? Oh, it's too cold, no, I won't do that, isn't it? That's what we do. And we don't sort of ever dive in. We don't actually share ourselves with the world. And to be honest with you, sharing yourself is a key part of your loving other people. If you can't share yourself, then you can't actually love other people. Right? So being yourself is about love of self. And sharing yourself is actually a lot about love of others. Not making them work to have a relationship with you. See, most of us make other people work for the relationship. And we have all sorts of addictive reasons why we do that. Some of which are based on pain, but some of which are based on control, you know. I've got to know that that person really wants it before I'll share myself. I've got to know whether that person's going to treat me good or not before I share myself. So you test people all the time. And that's exhausting if you're on the receiving end of that, isn't it? Having this person test you, and you know, you can speak the truth to them for 8 years and they still don't trust you. And why is that? Because people are just testing still. Still not dealing with the emotional reasons why they're doing that. And that makes it hard for anybody who's trying to interact with you. Yeah. Now you can also see that there are things that prevent me from being myself and sharing myself, isn't there? Right? Now obviously my facade is a huge thing that prevents me from being myself and sharing myself. I'm only sharing what I think I'm going to get something in return for. You see? Now that's not a choice to be your loving self, is it? Now you're making people work. They have to give you something in return. Anything you give them is not a gift. It's really a demand. So you give something hoping you'll get something in return. When they don't give you something in return, what do you feel? Oh, that person's not very nice. Right. And, you know, it ranges from, oh, that person's not very nice, to how dare that person, you know, do that to me. I gave them this and I gave them that and I did this for them and I did that for them and how dare they do that in return? Demonstrating our addictions in play. Now that stops me from being my real self. It stops me from being my loving self. It also prevents me from sharing my heart with others. So that's not a very wise choice to make. Staying in my pain is not going to be a wise choice to make, because what I do in my pain is I go around believing things of people that are not true. So you do this in relationships frequently, you know that, right? You blame your husband for things that really dad did all the time. Or you blame your wife for things your mum did all the time. Right. Now your wife or husband might be a little like that because the law of attraction of course also works, but even if they are, we don't trace it back to the real problem, which is the fact is I believe that they're going to do it even if they don't do it. Because I've got this pain in me and this pain believes things that are false and I think they're true. And while I'm in that place, I'm not going to make this choice to be my loving self, to share myself. I'm all there protecting myself. I'm sort of like a fighter, you know, looking to either punch somebody or defend myself from somebody. And so this is why a lot of relationships are actually antagonistic. It's why most relationships in terms of husband and wife relationships or partner relationships are combative and competitive, right? Because there's this internal feeling in both parties that I've got to prevent you from hurting me, right? And I'll only share myself as long as you don't hurt me. I'll only be myself as long as you don't hurt me. Other than that, all bets are off after that. After that, I'm not going to do it. You hurt me and that's it. Right? And then in most partnerships, you see a build-up of emotion over long periods of time that end in, like, you feel so angry that you can't, like, you know, you can't even have sex with the person anymore. You feel so angry. Right? And that's all part of us not being our real self right back at the beginning, modifying ourselves and eventually resenting the fact that we are modifying ourselves for the other person's consumption. Right? And we're doing that driven by our terror and our pain, our refusal to feel those particular things, aren't we? So that's a big problem too. So these two things, we need to feel about our self-expression. We need to make some personal commitments, develop some personal aspiration to actually share myself with others, be myself with others, no matter what the risk. And particularly when it says sharing yourself, I understand you might have certain times when you don't do that, and we'll talk about that later. But being yourself, no, that needs to happen all the time. That's an act of love of self. And it needs to be happening all the time. You need to be all the time being yourself. Right? There are times when you won't share yourself, and we'll talk about that. But there's certainly times, all times should be that you be yourself. And these things here, the facade, the addictions, the, you know, all of the different addictions we have, the facade, living in our pain, they prevent me from being myself. So obviously, if I was really committed to being myself, to become my loving self, if I was committed to developing my loving self, I would choose to deal with these things. Seeing that these things interfere with me being my loving self. They stop my development. They stop my progress. So naturally, these things should be removed. Right? And there should be some kind of desire to do that developed within myself. And if I don't have a desire to do it, develop one. Because I can develop my loving self by just even developing my desires and aspirations. Okay? Rita, you'd like to ask?
What if I...
If you hop up, because there's...
What if all your interactions were in facades and sharing yourself and you don't really know how to be anymore?
So you're not sharing yourself under the... If your actions in a facade, from my definition, you're not sharing yourself. You're sharing a lie of yourself.
Yeah, I'm totally aware of that. And as a result, I stay alone and be alone and thinking, and I do lots of writing every day and crying.
But wouldn't it be
better?
I don't
share myself because out of fear.
So you don't give me a chance. We're going to move on. You don't even give me a chance to answer your questions. You just don't, Rita. Judda, thanks. Can't even open my mouth when you're talking. Can't even interrupt some of the lies you tell yourself. You're too busy already trying to get the point across. So it can't be done. Chatter.
Is sharing myself going to feel childlike?
It's going to feel risky. It's probably the best way to put it. Risky. So if you're sharing yourself and it doesn't feel risky, then I suggest to you, you're not sharing yourself, but you're sharing your facade. Because your facade has been developed in order to mitigate or reduce your risks. You follow?
Yeah.
So if when you start really sharing your true self, your real feelings, you're going to feel it's going to feel very risky to you. Remember, this is where our global terror exists. It's going to feel very risky. When I say very risky, you're going to many times feel terrified doing it, literally terrified doing it. And if you're not feeling terrified sharing yourself, then you're just in an addiction, right? Because for the majority of people, and I'm saying unless you're very close to developing and feeling your pain, for the majority of us, we're not there yet. So for the majority of us, when you're sharing yourself, you feel quite scared, quite uncertain, quite like you're taking a big risk. And those are the feelings you're going to have until you work your way through the issue. Does that make sense?
Mm. Yeah.
Thanks. Yep. Thanks, Liz.
AJ, so does that mean every second that I'm withholding myself just a little, it is part of my facade and is a sin, even just withholding a bit?
Yep.
I know that's silly. But
makes sense, though, doesn't it, Liz?
So that means there's every time... all the times I'm withholding myself, I'm sinning.
Yes.
And that's adding to my pain.
When you stop yourself from being yourself in any situation, which is very different to sharing yourself, which we'll again talk about later, when you stop yourself from being yourself in any situation, you are automatically in your facade and you're automatically sinning. Yeah.
Thank you.
And there's automatically going to be a penalty for it. And many of those penalties are things like, many of you don't realize it, but many of the penalties are things like you develop a relationship and then later on a person finds out that you lied back at the beginning or that you didn't tell them the truth right at the beginning, right? And why don't we do that? It's because we were in the facade at the beginning. Right? And there's almost the presumption nowadays that if you begin a relationship with a person, that you're really just dealing with their facade for a long period of time, and over a period of time you'll eventually get to know them and eventually they'll let their guard down and eventually they'll share themselves with you. Well, obviously that's just wasting two people's time, isn't it? It's like, how long do I have to share my facade until my real self pokes out? And how are you going to react when my real self does poke out and you work out that actually a lot what was happening before then was just a facade? It's pretty upsetting, actually, when people do that to you, isn't it? So you can see that there's the sin of not being oneself actually does cause quite a lot of damage to relationships in the longer term, and also naturally has penalties associated with it, which are the damage that comes and the resulting unhappiness that comes from that damage. Yeah.
Well, thank you.
Good question, though. Okay. Is there any other questions about being oneself? Shula, thanks.
So to be yourself, then how do you know that it is yourself?
Well, as I said, if you listen to that answer, you'll see that when you're being yourself, usually there's high risks involved. Personally, that's what it feels like. Whereas when you're being your facade, usually it feels like there's less risk involved because your facade has been modified to suit the people around you. Yourself has yet to be developed or even expressed, and therefore yourself is quite terrified of sharing itself with others or being itself with others. And so yes, you're going to feel that, what I said to Judah. That's one very good way of measuring. The other, of course, is by looking at the results you get. But you can't always measure results based on pain or pleasure. You've got to measure results based on truth and love. So when you're measuring results based on pain and pleasure, you go, oh, I shared myself, or I was myself with that person, they just attacked me. That, to me, that's not a justification of not being yourself anymore. Right? But if you're addicted to pain or pleasure, that is a justification. And this is the problem with it being addicted to just pain or pleasure. It's going to stop you from making the loving choice or the truthful choice. Yeah. So we've got to be careful how we measure things, but it's quite obvious that whenever we have a lot of terror or fear, there's probably a good indication we're doing the right thing.
Okay, thanks.
right? We're actually going ahead and doing the right thing. For the majority of us, you know, sometimes it's different, but for the majority of us, we have a lot of terror or fear about being ourselves. Yeah. Paul, thanks.
It's really exhausting for myself, I think, if I let myself out a bit and socially, and then...
Why is it exhausting, Paul? What do you feel when you feel exhausted?
Well, I want to rest off it. I want to rest off the risk of being exposed.
Yeah, but it's only exhausting because you're preventing the fear of the risk. You're suppressing an emotion while you're attempting to share yourself. Because what I actually find is it's actually more relaxing to share yourself or be yourself than it is to present a facade to somebody. Because a facade, you've got to think about it. You've got to work, you know, what about this person? What do they want from me? You've got to, there's a whole heap of things you've got to do. But when you're really sharing, being yourself, you don't have to do those things anymore. So it's actually relaxing. So if you're not finding it relaxing, it's because you're not allowing the fear emotion to be felt while you're doing it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's living in the fear.
Yeah, it's sort of like, it's not so much living in the fear. Fear takes an effort to suppress. And this is one of the things that many of you struggle to acknowledge, that a lot of the tiredness and exhaustion you feel is because you have to have a supreme effort to resist emotion. Does that make sense to you?
Yep.
And the effort of resisting emotion causes your pain, causes the exhaustion. So what we need to do in any situation is be ourselves, and whatever emotion we feel while we're being ourselves, allow it to be experienced. Now, if we do that, we won't come away exhausted from the problem, from the issue. We'll come away refreshed. We'll come away like alive, and we can go from situation to situation to situation to situation without feeling exhaustion. But as soon as we start suppressing some emotion, now there's an effort to do that. It requires energy. It sucks energy from us to do that. So it's going to be an exhausting process, suppressing the emotion. So that's the reason for the exhaustion.
Yeah, like if I've been out or out socially, I'll need to come home and feel a lot of the stuff which I wasn't feeling while I was there as well.
Yeah.
It's like, but if I had been present to that at the time, then I wouldn't need that time to...
That's right.
To get back on the level in a sense.
Yes, that's right. But the reality is the environment at that time might not have allowed you to feel those emotions either. So this is where we've got to talk about sharing yourself, and there are some limitations to sharing yourself because of the potential environments you're in. But we'll talk about that in our next presentation. But for the most part, we need to learn to be ourselves no matter what, right? And if we be ourselves no matter what, you won't come away from situations feeling exhausted. You'll come away from situations feeling the same as what you felt when you went into them. You know, you won't have a loss of energy.
Yeah. Well, that's the hard thing because it's one challenge to take the risk.
Yeah.
But then the next challenge is to feel the feelings while I'm taking the risk.
Correct.
It's like,
correct.
It's like, how do I do that?
Yeah. And that's the important thing to learn to do.
And actually, you're, I think, one of the few people that I've ever been able to do that with. In your presence, I feel like I can do that a bit, but not much with others.
Yeah. So the reality is the more loving a person is towards you, the more they'll allow you to do that. So that's also a great way of measuring how loving you think the environment is, isn't it? If you're taking a risk, and whatever you feel can come up while you're taking the risk, then it tends to indicate that the environment is probably fairly loving, allowing you to express your emotions in a loving manner. Does that make sense?
Yep.
But if you're taking a risk and you feel exhausted in the environment, then it probably indicates the environment's a bit like... is trying to prevent you from taking the risk. It's trying to prevent you from being yourself.
Yeah.
So therefore, you know, if you come away exhausted from an environment, it's always a good sign, because you can go back and look at the environment and go, yeah, what was put towards me in that place. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yep. Yep. Very sense.
Young children love to dress up and act out. I remember as a little boy, I used to do it all the time.
Yeah.
And they can become someone else in that play. Why do they do that?
Well, there's possibly two reasons. One is just an expression of some fun, and the other is trying to get some approval from their environment. So you have to work out which one it is, don't you? But I don't know if it's too much on the subject, Maurice.
Well, I used to dress up to escape from the feeling of not being loved and
so driven,
to work out who I was.
So driven by the environment.
Absolutely.
Driven by the projections of the environment.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. If we go to Pamela.
Could the actions that you take when you're trying to be yourself, well, being yourself, could they be the same as your facade but with different feeling intentions?
I don't think so, Pamela, no.
No.
The facade is, you've got to be careful here because we're pretty, like, weaselly, you know? Many of you will feel initially like you're trying to do it, but if you're honest with yourself, you'll see that, it's just a modification of your facade now in an attempt to fool yourself that you're trying to do it.
Oh, right.
Unless you get to feel some of this terror, unless you feel some fear doing it, it's highly unlikely you're doing it.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yep. Thanks. Yep. Thank you.
So we just need to be careful there. Ben, thank you.
Just a bit about what Paul was saying. I've cried a couple of times here, and there's like 50 people in the room.
Yeah.
But I have trouble crying at home with my wife.
Yeah.
That's my mother.
Well, there's a number of reasons, Ben, but firstly, I'm in control to a degree of this environment. So that means that you know that I certainly will encourage you to feel your emotions. And therefore, the person who's in primary control of an environment will, to a large degree, determine your openness to feeling things in that environment. Does that make sense? So the majority of you find that you cry sometimes when you're in one of our sessions for that reason. When you go home, your environment's completely different. Now, in the case with your wife, there is a whole lot of addiction at play where you've got to portray to your wife that you've actually got her safety in heart. And she, the only way she's going to feel really safe is for her husband not to feel like he can't handle things or can't cry, right? He has to not cry in order for her to feel that way. Now, that's also came from your mother more so than your wife, because Zoe does allow a person to cry. So it's indicating that you've still got the belief at play with your mother, and then you believe that to be the case with your wife, rather than it actually necessarily being the case with her. Do you follow?
Yeah, I thought it was the same as the other thing where my mother didn't allow the tears for whatever that, what I was, that feeling.
Yeah. So there's false beliefs at play in your relationship where you feel you're not allowed to. With me, I'm a male, you don't have any women-based addictions with me. So it's going to be a lot easier for you to cry in my company than it is in your wife's company for that reason.
And this is more about you than them.
Correct, because I've got control of the environment. Does that make sense? I'm determining the condition of love of the environment to a degree, because I'm saying to you, if you treat people unlovingly, you'll be out the door, right? So I've got some level of control of the environment. I've created the event. I've got responsibility for the event, therefore, for the most part, I determine what the environment is going to do.
So I feel very safe here.
Like. Yeah, you obviously do feel safer here. But the reality is your false belief says that you're not safe with any woman. Even if that woman was safe, you wouldn't feel safe with her. Does that make sense? Okay, well, let's move forward, because we want to just discuss some of the other things. There's so many things we could discuss in here, by the way. How do you limit your self-expression with your soulmate? Because we need to learn to be open with our soulmate, don't we? If we're going to if we're going to progress. So how do you limit self-expression with your soulmate? Have some guesses there. Maybe if we go to Dave and then Kelly at the front here.
By not expressing or experimenting with your real desires?
Yes, so instead of tuning into what your real desires are, if you're tuning into a woman partner's desires all the time, then actually you're limiting your own self-expression with that partner. So it's actually, even though you're doing it to get their approval, it's actually counterproductive.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
It's interesting, isn't it? Yeah. Kelly?
Oh, well, just living in my fear, living in my need for somebody else to depend on or look after.
So living in the addictions themselves.
Yeah.
So codependent addictions.
Yes.
Very, very bad for you being yourself, and it's a bad choice you're making. If you want to develop your loving self, it's not a good choice, because codependent addictions are going to prevent you from being your loving self.
Yeah.
And also probably prevent you from being yourself even, because you're in the facade-based addictions with others. So that's not going to be very good for your development, is it?
Not at all.
So these codependent addictions are one of the most damaging things you can get involved in, because they feel good while at the same time damaging you and the other party and your relationship.
Mm.
And so it's, you know, frequently it's not very good at all. To truly attract your soulmate, you've got to be you, not be what you think they want you to be. Yeah. And they need to be them rather than be what you want them to be.
Yeah. We've helped each other prevent all of that.
Yes.
Very well.
Yeah. That's right, and it needs to be undone. And when you're in a partnership and you're living together, undoing that can be sometimes very hard, because there's already the codependent addictions, the bartering system's all in play. And when one person starts confronting the bartering system, the other person goes, I'm not being loved anymore, you know, because their false belief is all about addictions. Someone meeting my addictions is love, and I feel like I'm not being loved anymore. Somebody say it?
And the competition for the power struggle.
Yeah.
That.
Like for many of you in the audience, when I stop you in this audience from meeting your addictions, you instantly feel like you're not loved by me. Mm. Right? You do. And this is a big problem in a relationship. Imagine that's happening all the time in the relationship, where one person's trying to stop their addictions with you and you're going, he's not loving me now, he's not loving me now, he's not loving me now. And eventually, if you hammer him enough, he might go back to his addictions with you, just to prevent getting hammered, you know. Just so you can see that in the relationship phase, it requires two people to focus on their addictions and to remove the codependency. And it also requires a special kind of thought with regard to choice, isn't it? Saying, I am choosing to confront my addictions, and I know in that place that's going to feel sometimes like I'm not being loved, and it's going to make the other person feel sometimes like they are not being loved, even though we're trying to deconstruct the process. And instead of making a decision to leave each other, which because we both not love each other anymore, right, which is highly unlikely, isn't it? We're now loving each other more by not feeding each other's addictions.
Yeah.
But the problem is you don't feel that at the time. You feel like there's nothing between us anymore. Like before, we used to do this and that and this and that, and all this codependent addiction going on, and now there's nothing going on. Now there's nothing going on at all. Like I don't feel like having sex with them. They don't feel like having sex with me. They just go off doing their own. I do my own thing. And this is because the real self has yet to be developed in love, while at the same time we're attempting to deconstruct the facade self. And so you go through this period where you go, I don't know if I love him anymore. You do. And you can't, and the reality is that you never did. Does that make sense?
Yes, definitely.
That's from God's point of view, you never did love them. But because you were just in codependent addiction with them, so you never really did love them. But when you go through that period, it's sort of like really confronting in the relationship. That's when most people just walk away and try another person. Mm. And my suggestion is no, don't go walking away until you've gotten through the terror here and gotten through some of this pain and false beliefs. Because unless you do that, highly likely you're going to walk away and then injure each other further. If particularly if you're already soulmates and you're already together, you might not know that.
Mm.
And so then you break up, hurt each other, break up, go off with somebody else, and then all of a sudden you realise, oh, geez, you know, now that I've dealt with that emotionally, I think they're my soulmate after all that type of thing.
And Have to go back now
somehow. Have to, and now that, are they going to accept you back? I don't know. You know, like, there's all that pain that goes on. So you can avoid a lot of that by understanding that when you deconstruct this facade and deconstruct the addiction, once you use your will to become more loving, make the choice to do it, that it's going to be confrontational to both of you in the relationship. And therefore, it's unwise to make choices and decisions during this phase. The main choice and decision you need to make is just to be your loving self, remove the addictions, let yourself feel the results of the barter, you know, what the barter was and what's going on. Let yourself go through that and then come out the other end of that. And now you're in the, well, you know, I'm starting to connect to my real self. What does it feel like? Do they feel like they are the same as my real self or not? Then you'll know. Then you'll feel whether that person's your soulmate or not.
I just wanted to ask, though, whilst we're living together and challenging those addictions,
mm-hmm.
which we're wanting to do now, how trying to confront the global terror
yep.
whilst I still feel safe and secure under
it's not you're not going to feel safe and secure.
No.
Hmm.
No.
And if he's removed if Bruce has removed his addictions with you, he won't be trying to make you feel safe and secure.
Yeah. Like providing for myself the whole lot.
Yeah.
That I
emotionally,
think,
physically,
yeah.
Sexually, financially.
Everything.
Everything.
It's pretty confronting.
Pretty confronting, yeah.
Yeah.
Most people are in codependent addiction, at least on one of or usually all of those things in a relationship. So that's all pretty confronting. And then the key is now, if he does the same as that, as you, then what will happen is anything that draws you together will be based on love that you feel for each other, not based on bartering system with each other.
Yeah, yep. Neediness.
Yeah, neediness. The vortex is getting, you know, sucked in. I often liken it to a big vacuum cleaners, you know, we got going out there.
Feels horrible.
You know, it's like, and that's what it's like.
We've been doing that to each other.
And you know how that sounds? It doesn't sound very good. That's how it feels too if you get used to it. You know, it feels, ooh, sleazy.
Now it's starting to feel that sleazy. It doesn't feel right.
Yeah. And once you get rid of that in the relationship, then you have the capacity to love each other without those things.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Bruce, you want to say?
not to respond to that, but how I'm sort of in that phase, and I've got this thing keeps coming up that I'm being selfish.
That's one of
I'm
your
withholding, and I'm yeah, soul. Things.
It's one of the false beliefs. So one of the false beliefs is that it's an act of selflessness to feed another person's addictions. Mm. It's a false belief. It's actually a very damaging act to feed another person's addictions. But when we stop feeding the other person's addictions, sometimes we will feel selfish. But it is a false belief of, it's not real selfishness because you're actually doing something to help the person, not harm them.
Yeah, even going and doing, you know, things by myself.
Yep.
Opposed to doing it as a couple sort
yep.
of thing.
Yeah.
Because I want to do it.
Yeah.
Because it's something that I want to do.
Yeah.
I desire to do, whether it's in another slight addiction or addiction or.
Well, this
not,
is what you experiment with, right?
Yeah. Yep. So those are things. But yep. in that point, you know, we've obviously run into it. Is that I feel it's selfish. Kel gets upset about it. That it is selfish, basically, or she feels it is. Yeah. And so she.
The
goes
person who's had their addictions met by, so in this case, by men, is going to think when the man's off doing his own thing that he's being selfish. But actually, the selfishness is when you get the addiction met, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'm being selfish. If I want you to meet my addiction, aren't I being selfish?
Yeah. But, the big but.
Well, no, you see, you haven't processed the pain emotionally, yeah. Bruce. So you're not going to believe that.
No, because I've got that thing of I'm being generous or nice or, you know, or responsive or whatever, you know, responsible.
You've got both things going on. You've got the positive feeding of the addiction is a generosity on your part, is the way you see it, and the withdrawal from the addiction you call it selfishness. Yeah. And both of those things are actually an error.
No wonder I'm dizzy.
But everyone's like that. It's not just you. It's like, honestly, this is how we are with addictions. We think when we feed another person's addictions, we're being a good guy. It's real nice. We're doing the right thing by them. And when we don't feed their addictions, we think we're not doing the right thing by them. We're just being selfish now. So we've got both of those things are errors. Feeding an addiction of another person is an unloving act under any circumstance. And requesting they feed mine is an unloving demand in any circumstance. So I need to come to see that. But to see that, I need to release some of my emotional false beliefs to see that. And that's only by processing some of the pain that drove that behavior. Yeah. Yep.
Thanks.
All right. Now, let's talk about two more things that I'd like to raise in this area. One is the difference between sort of aspiration. And inspiration. So aspiration being the feeling being developed from within myself to choose to develop my loving self. Inspiration being someone else external to me encouraging me to be my loving self or to develop my loving self. Now, the problem with inspiration is that you can become addicted to it, can't you? You can. And this is a big issue that many of you have. Some of you know, over years, you've often become addicted to inspiration. Even before you met me, many of you were already addicted to it, where you'd go along to some kind of New Age thing or go along to some spiritual development or go along to some talk or go along to something that was really interesting that inspires you. And we can become sort of like, what would you call that? Seminar junkies. Like, you know, just needing the inspiration from someone else because we haven't got any aspiration within ourselves, right? So it's very important to develop your loving self. You're going to need to develop aspiration, a feeling from within yourself that you want to change, a feeling from within yourself that you're going to change. Rather than just rely on somebody else inspiring you to change all the time. Does that make sense? Yep. Now, in your outline, you'll see a whole list I've made of addictions that get involved in wanting inspiration. I'm not going to go through them because I haven't got the time, but there is just a whole list of them. All these different things that we do needing inspiration are all driven by many of these addictions. So my suggestion is to, if you have found yourself needing inspiration all the time, have a look at those addictions, that addiction list. And it's not exhaustive. It's just a list that myself and Mary made in a few minutes of all the different kinds of addictions that might be in play that cause you to desire to have somebody else inspire you. The real key is recognizing that you don't have an aspiration from within yourself and then developing one. Now, to develop anything is like developing the will muscle. It requires all the things that we talked about in that presentation in 2014 about development. So develop your aspiration rather than relying too much on inspiration. It's not bad to have inspiration, but you've got to make sure also that the inspiration comes from sources that are loving. Because if your inspiration is coming from sources that are unloving, then all they're going to do is inspire you towards evil, which is the opposite of what you want if you want to develop your loving self. Dina?
Thanks. I've discovered I've got an addiction and have had for quite a while to inspiring other people.
Yeah.
to feed my worth and specialness and things like that.
Makes you sort of feel valid.
And it feels really yucky, like as I've been, you know, like seeing that more. Then getting away from that and wanting to, like, share myself more without, like, meeting that addiction feels like I don't quite know.
I'd agree that that's the case. But one of them is the addiction to feeling like you have a role, that you're feeling like you have some kind of I feel this is a very common addiction because frequently I get people come up, they want me to tell them what their special thing is that they are going to do for the world. And I say, well, you might not do anything. Because what is it all about? It's about will.
Yeah, it's
choice.
About,
choice
yeah.
is like what you choose to do, right? So finding out for somebody whether you've got special, unique talent in this area or that area or this area or that area is really pointless. What you need to do is discover your own talents and abilities, and which are part of your nature and character, develop them, and then share them with humility with the world. And when you do that, you're not wanting to get some result. You're just doing it because that's your passion. That's what you like doing. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah. All right, let's have a look at the last thing we need. And unfortunately, I haven't got a lot of time to spend on this, but it's really important. So developing desire. Whoops. Now, God's all about purifying desire. So all of God's laws will attempt to purify your desire. And desire is a very important part of your relationship with God, because if you think about it, desire for God is prayer. A desire to receive God's love is a prayer to receive God's love. A desire to receive God's truth is a prayer to receive God's truth. So many of us don't have a desire. We think we do, but the emotional condition is that we don't. The emotional condition is developed by what's going on here inside of ourselves frequently, and that's determining our desire. Now, when we have a large amount of terror within us, we start to manufacture desires in our head, and they're not desires. They're thoughts in order to avoid the fact that we have no real desire. The way to measure desire I've found is to see what you automatically do. Because whatever you automatically do is an indication of your real desire. So if you automatically pray, then that means you have a real desire to pray. But if you don't automatically pray and you have to force yourself to pray, that means you don't have a desire. Does that make sense? Now, what do you automatically feed your addictions? Well, if you do automatically feed your addictions, then that's your desire. You need to deconstruct that desire and replace it with a different one, a more helpful one. Does that make sense? So look at what you automatically do without trying, what's easy to do, and that will tell you your current state of your desire. Does that make sense to everyone? So you can do it with truth, you can do it with emotion. Do you automatically suppress emotion or feel it? So if you automatically suppress it, that tells you there's your real desire. No matter what you're telling yourself in your head, that's your real desire. Your real desire is to suppress it. So then you can work on that, right? With regard to truth, if you find yourself automatically repelling it, and that's automatic process, then what's your desire? Your desire is to reject truth. So that's your automatic desire. That tells you what your real desire is. You can change your desires, of course. But you need to understand that if your automatic desire is to reject truth, the best thing to do is find out why you want to reject truth. See, if you know what your desire is, then you can deconstruct it or work through what causes it, can't you? But if you don't know what your desire is, or you tell yourself your desire is one thing when it's not, you're going to be totally confused. And this is why many of you are confused when we talk about emotional things, because inside of you, you've got desires that you're not acknowledging, And as automatic behaviours, it drives automatic feelings and behaviours that you have, and you're not acknowledging that. The key is to acknowledge it. Wow, you know, in this situation, I automatically do that. In this situation, I automatically do that. That's my real desire. That's my will. That's my real will. Do I want that to continue anymore? Well, if it's unloving, I don't. So what am I now going to do? I now need to see why I feel that desire is the best thing to do. I need to start analysing the desire and the underlying emotions that drive that desire. Does that make sense to everyone? It's a very simple way of discovering what you really feel rather than what you think you feel. Makes sense, doesn't it? Very simple way. And that's what I would suggest to you. Discover what you really feel by seeing what you automatically do. And when you know you automatically do these things, then you know, well, that's what my real desire is. So if I'm not automatically praying every day, then my real desire is to not pray. And then I need to ask myself, well, why? What's driving that? What do I feel? And this is where you'll start confronting a lot of your false beliefs about God. You know, God's not listening anyway. You know, he's not going to give me what I want anyway. He's not going to give me his love because I probably feel like I don't deserve it, or whatever it is. But if you find you're not automatically praying, then it means that you don't automatically have a desire to receive God's love. That means that there's no desire in you to receive God's love at this point, and that can be developed by only getting rid of the reason why the opposite exists. Right? Whatever is the opposite and why that exists needs to be felt and released. It's a very simple way. It's helped me a lot. A very simple way of working out what I really feel about things. That make sense? Rather than, because your mind's a tricky little thing, right? Slippery little sucker it is. It's going to do exactly what the pain dictates, right? So the only real way you're going to know what your real passions and desires are by seeing what you automatically do and then analysing that and then asking yourself, well, if that's what I automatically do, the next question, of course, is why? What causes me to do that? What belief in me causes me to do that? And you'll discover some of your false beliefs very rapidly that way. Okay? So, but desire is a key element. We want to talk about the law of desire later on when we talk about laws, because it's a very important law. It's going to help you throughout your entire progression. But you've got to see what you truly desire, and what you truly desire is what you automatically feel impelled to do. And you've got to see that before you can actually deal with it and work out what are proper desires. But there's two desires that are critical. The first desire is for God's love. So if I feel like, yeah, I in the course of a day I don't ask God for love. It's not automatic. I've got to force myself to sit down and pray and long for it. That's what I've got to force myself to do. So my real desire is to not do it. I'd be better off trying to find all the reasons why I don't want to do it, right? And the next thing, obviously, is for God's truth. And the same applies there. My real desire is to reject God's truth. For most of us, that's the case. We still haven't deconstructed our facade. So our real desire is to reject God's truth. So rather than ask... sorry about that. Rather than asking for God's truth, right, we'd be better off saying, I don't want God's truth. That's my real desire. Why? I know God's truth is essential if I want to be educated in love and grow in love and develop as a person. So why is it that I'm rejecting God's truth? And then you start to discover lots of things about what you believe about God's truth, that it's going to hurt you, that it's going to be harmful, that it's going to be hard, and a number of other things will start coming up. Different emotions will start being triggered if you allow yourself to discover those things. But in the end, we do need to develop desire as a part of developing my loving self, and in particular desire for God's truth and God's love. Without that, no education can occur. All right, well, that's my choice to develop my loving self. So what we're going to do next is have a look, after we do a Q&A on the subject, we're going to have a look at my choice to be my loving self. So one is the act of developing it, what I'm going to need to develop myself, and the other is what I'm going to need to be aware of when I actually just be myself. And we'll compare those two things. So let's have a break now for 10 minutes. If we come back at 25 past. Thanks, guys.